Day two, the plenary session. I'm very honoured to be chairing two distinguished speakers. I am not going to give them long introductions. We're going to get straight into it. The first up this morning is Professor James Ferguson from Aberdeen Hospital, Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, excuse me, is an emergency physician. He's going to be talking about technology-enabled care in emergency medicine. James.
Thanks, Lee. Good morning, everybody. Before I get started on my slides, what I'd like to do is share with you a short 5-minute video demonstrating an episode of unscheduled care using technology that I was involved in approximately 10 years ago, and I may be asking questions about this afterwards, so please pay attention. Can we run the video, please?
Raise 500,000. Fold.
Thank you.
Fold. Fold.
Wins.
Deal, ma'am.
Sorry, sir. You are the big blind.
Small blind, please.
Vaughn's been poisoned. He's going into cardiac arrest.
Stay calm.
And don't interrupt, because you'll be dead within 2 minutes unless you do exactly what I tell you.
I'm all ears.
Remove the defibrillator from the pouch.
Do not know what it is yet. I'm still scanning.
Attach the leads to your chest.
Ventricular tachycardia, digitalis. What the hell do we give him? Okay, that's amphetamine.
As soon as it reads charge, okay, that'll work. Bond.
Don't push the red button.
Yeah, do you hear me? Don't push it yet.
His heart's gonna stop.
It's only time for one charge before he passes out.
Take the blue combi pen, Bond. Mid-neck, into the vein.
That'll counteract the digitalis.
Going to pass out in a few seconds, and you need to keep your heart going. Push the red button now, Bond.
Bond, push the damn button.
Do it now.
You okay?
me.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'll get yourself off to hospital.
I will do. As soon as I've won this game.
They're not seriously going back there.
I wouldn't dream of it.
Bet. 1 million.
Hey. So if I could have my slides, please. Now remember, there will be questions.
Paul, Orin, gentlemen, shut down, please.
Good. So my name is James Ferguson. I'm an AE consultant.
Aces and sevens.
As Lee's already said, but I'm also the clinical lead for the Scottish Centre for Telehealth and Telecare. And my talk's about technology-enabled care and emergency medicine. So, if, for those of you who don't know, this is Scotland. Now, most people think of Scottish people as being aggressive, kilt-wearing, golf-playing individuals. That's clearly not true. Right, so, that scene from Casino Royale, I wrote that, and it was changed. Some of you will notice the medicine's not too great because a couple of medical students on set changed it to digitalis from a tricyclic overdose. But anyway, I'll forgive them for that. But Skyfall is still the best performing James Bond movie ever. And it has that sort of distinction, but it also has the other distinction of absolutely, unequivocally making it clear that James Bond is Scottish. Now, when we were thinking about storylines for Spectre and what we could put in there, I came up with an idea that actually there may be another organization apart from Spectre that is actually infiltrating our civilizations and killing off our population by infiltrating our healthcare systems. So instead of Spectre, we call that Sloth. And Sloth is the secret league opposed to health, okay? And they achieve their objectives by creating chaos. Does anybody know what chaos stands for? That's choose hospital admission as only solution, okay? And yesterday, well, in fact, quite usefully, Salah Forres, I read his paper from 2014 outlining the large numbers of patients who come to your ED, and Colin Graham helpfully had a session yesterday on misuse of the ED department. That's why I'm wearing a Hong Kong tie today, just to honour Colin. And the thing is, this is a big problem around the world with ED overcrowding. So which environment causes this? And these are the important things we want to think. Increased mortality by 20%, increased errors, increased complaints and litigation. Well, it's emergency department crowding. When your ED is full, and the ED is a barometer of how your healthcare system's working, any system that gets overloaded performs worse. So when you get overloaded, you get any more, errors occurring. And this is the data behind that. And when you are getting up to 12-hour waits in the ED, your mortality is increased by 20%. Now, most of these patients will be in the last year of life, if you look at the data. And you can adjust this, you can argue the absolute numbers, but the trend is the same everywhere. So to a certain extent, by encouraging people to come to the hospital, rather than trying to sort them or triage them or treat them before they come, can be a bad thing if you overload the system. So effectively, if you take somebody at home who's unwell but could be managed at home and stick them into a hospital, this is what you're doing. You're just transferring them from one adverse environment to another one. So how is Sloth attacking the people in our hospitals? Well, they do this by two things. Over-triage, i.e. sending patients to hospital just in case they're unwell and overloading the system, or by default, because you don't actually have primary care services or community services that can deliver that care, so by default they come to the ED, even though it's not really an emergency problem. So what we're going to talk about is over-triage for the rest of the talk, is how do we reduce large numbers of patients coming to the ED inappropriately by using technology. Because for for picking up the ones at the top that need to be there, we are treating a large number of patients who don't need to be seen. Colin spoke about this yesterday, that we always assess patients from the point of view that they may have something seriously wrong with them, and therefore we end up spending a lot of time, whereas if we could filter them out earlier, we might be able to improve our system. So, back to Scotland. We always do things slightly different. So, with our technology, so M, who is our health minister a few years ago, about 10 years ago when that bond clip came out, set up the Scottish Centre for Telehealth and Telecare. And basically, we're a facilitating organisation that looks at the evidence, encourages and facilitates the adoption of new methods of delivering care across all healthcare, but including unscheduled care. And I'm there because I'm an EM consultant, because that's where we feel the pressure. So, for the rest of my talk, what I'm going to do is take you through this cycle and show you some examples of what we're doing in Scotland. The first lot will be mainly towards unscheduled care, and then towards the end I'll show you some of the things that were implemented in the community that might reduce attendance at the hospital. So I want you to think of the whole population as people with potential illness. When something happens to them, we triage them. If they're triaged as requiring to be seen, we have a formal clinical assessment. Then we do investigations as required, we treat them, then usually they get monitored for a period of time before they return to the general population and back to normal or back to their chronic disease state. So for each of these, how can we introduce increased pressure, reach out to them? And this is all about thinking differently. This is all about thinking, does this patient need to be in the hospital? Can I actually deliver the care to this patient much more efficiently and more cost effectively? We've got good data on that in the community. So this is what we're aiming for. A patient should be assessed, diagnosed, and treated, and only be transferred to hospital if there is demonstrable clinical benefit from them attending the hospital. Because the problem is, in the community, when you're faced with someone who appears unwell, it is really difficult to make the decision whether or not they can be treated. And usually, by default, or by fear factor or whatever, people will over-triage into the hospital just to be safe. So what we really need, and there's a large amount of variation, and this is the problem, this is what we need to do. There's so much variation out in the community. So a paramedic, a doctor, or whatever may not have the experience to send it in, so they tend to send the patient in. So what they need is improved assessment of the patient, access to diagnostics, so they can make the best decision about where that patient, and therefore we need to make sure that everybody does this the same way if we want to reduce variation. Variation is the enemy of any process, every process. So let's start with triage. So in Scotland, in the UK, we have a telephone triage service called NHS 24, NHS Direct in England, which is a telephony-based service, which if somebody has a problem that maybe doesn't require an ambulance, they will phone up for advice. So what we did was, that was fine, but what we found was, because they speak to a nurse or a paramedic for advice, when they've reached the level of their decision-making, they send the patient into hospital. So what we did was we put in consultants above that. So we had emergency medicine consultants in my department who, if they didn't know what to do and weren't sure, they could speak to a consultant. And basically, for the GP referred, so when doctors referred, we were able to reduce the transfers by 18%, and we were able to redirect the patients to other parts of the hospital in about 33%. It was higher for paramedics. Through decision support, we were able to avoid attendance of 41% and streamline the others. So, by giving direct access to expertise, you can reduce the number of transfers or attendances at your department. Now, think about this. This is using telephony. Imagine if you can add pictures to this. We could actually take the doctor to the patient's home to assess them earlier, and I'm going to speak about that a little bit later. Now, I want to tell you about our ambulance service. Our ambulance service is a single ambulance service run by the government, staffed by paramedics. However, we are still dispatching using the MPDS system, which was first set up in 1973. How many people in the room were not born in 1973? Well, you're not going to tell me. But the point is, the world has changed since then. And the thing is, we are massively over-triaging ambulances to high-priority cases. And what we found was, we looked at the, just for an example, when we sent someone who was supposed to have an airway problem, sent an ambulance with an 8-minute response time, it was 25 cases, ambulance we had to send before you would get one where an intervention needed to be carried out. And if we can immediately, if we can actually apply some science to this, we can reduce this and triage our ambulances much more effectively and reduce transfers to hospital. So at the moment, 6 years ago, we started a system whereby, and we have a thing called the Community Health Index in Scotland. Every person in Scotland has their own identifiable number. And we started a project back in 2010 that allowed us to follow every patient through every emergency care incident. So we now have the best database in the world regarding what the outcomes of these are. And what we're finding is massive over-triage. So for the next year, we're going to look at all these outcomes and try a different system and trial it. We think it's going to be much more effective and allow us to deliver care much more effectively. Okay, so that's triage. Let's go on to formal clinical assessment. Nearly 20 years ago now, we set up a system whereby we have a lot of small rural hospitals in Scotland, they're all marked there, and they were sending large numbers of minor injuries through to the main department in Aberdeen. So what we did was we put in a video conferencing link into every community hospital, and we were able to look at the x-rays and then see the patient. And we reduced transfers by 85% to the ED. Now, people started saying to me, but you don't need the video conferencing, you just need to see the x-ray and a telephone. And I thought, that's rubbish. It's always better to see the patient. So what we did was we got a bunch of EM consultants and trainees in a room, and we showed them an x-ray with a history of the patient, and then we showed them the video consultation with the patient and asked them, would they transfer the patient through? And this is the data we found out. Basically, even the consultants, when we added the video, it halved the transfer rate. So why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you do it? You would never go into a consultation room with a patient and close your eyes and only open them when you felt it was appropriate. Why not press the button and switch on the video conferencing? And we did further studies. We did this study with Cisco looking at patients walking off street with medical problems. So people who were triaged by NHS 24 to go to a GP consultation came into us. And what we did was they were all seen on two occasions, either being by two doctors face-to-face or by a doctor and by video conferencing. That was just because we know if two doctors see the same patients, they don't always come up with the same answer. And what we found was, so we had it set up there, they came in, we had all these diagnostics at the far end, we could do blood tests, we could put a stethoscope on their chest. Somebody at the far end of the corridor consulted with them. No difference in the two modalities. Only things that were tight were abdominal examination, and everybody was scared of kids under the age of one. Everything else we were able to do just as well using video conferencing. Okay, now let's think about kids, because kids are... Now, that gives you a nice warm feeling as emergency physicians. That's my daughter, Louise, 21 years ago or whatever, or maybe 20 years ago. That gives you a warm feeling. When you see a kid who's that sick, you want to do this, okay? And so that is a very... We did some studies that showed that remote practitioners are absolutely terrified by kids. So what we did was we went, Scotland has rural general hospitals, I don't know if I can point out, got rural general hospitals in the islands and up the west coast, which is very rural. And what we did was in those hospitals, we put in video conferencing, and if they had a child, they phoned NHS 24, NHS 24 rang through to an A&E consultant. Sorry, I'm going the wrong way. They got through an A&E consultant, could be at home. Some of them had the video conferencing at home, so you could do this overnight from home. It was a bridge, so they would dial into a video conferencing bridge. So that end dials in, they dial in. If we need the retrieval team or we need a specialist opinion, they can dial in and see the patient at the far end and then give advice on how to manage them. What we found was the hospitals were completely different. They all had different levels of training, they had different levels of kit, they had different levels of everything in there. So as we say, if you've seen one rural hospital, you've seen one rural hospital because it's different from every other one. So variation, again, difficult to provide a really good consistent service. But what we did was we put out to peer review the cases, and what did we find? A 33% increase in quality of care and a 25% reduction in transfer of these patients. And these are conservative estimates. So we are looking at doing this on a national service. Now, what we're really thinking of doing, remember I told you about the video? This time last week, yesterday, our health minister launched our latest initiative, which is VC Anywhere, which is a platform which allows us to video conference into patients' homes. And basically what they do is if they phone up and say that, you know, I need to be seeing my child, I think my child's unwell, or anything else, they're sent a URL, they open their browser, click on the URL, they get taken through to their own waiting room. The doctor who is supervising that session sees they're there. When he's got time, he clicks on, and he can see the child. For those of you who do pediatric ED, and that's my subspecialty, you know, I know 50 to 60% of the patients I see in the pediatric hospital in Aberdeen is just parental anxiety, and they come and they wait. If we can reassure them like this by sending a picture, and being able to see the patient, because that child looks pretty well to me, doesn't really need to come to the ED. So we'll be able to treat them, or at least we can make an appointment for an outpatient consultation. Okay, so that's formal clinical assessment. Now we're going into investigation. So this is Q branch. So moving on, things we've done. ECGs, I saw from Sal's paper that cardiovascular is a big problem over here. For a long time we've been able to send ECGs, remotely. Obviously, if you've got STEMI, if you've got an ST elevation infarct, you're going to try to get to the cath lab. However, sometimes you can't get the cath lab if you're in an oil rig or in a boat or in a rural area. You can't make the cath lab in 8 minutes. The fastest anyone will be treated for a myocardial infarction out with hospital in Scotland is in the North Sea, because all of the rigs have got ECG transmission and they have thrombolytic. And the patients go straight. They don't wait 4 hours. A lot of people wait with their chest pain before they can't help. They go straight to the rig medic. They get thrombolyzed within 2 hours. Study, great study from 1990 in Grampian, where I work, showed within 2 hours, thrombolysis can be as effective as angioplasty. So we can treat them more fast. The other thing we're doing, Richard Lyons, I hope is here, but we have started a study in Grampian where we are looking at cardiac arrest, where we have trained non-healthcare professionals in CPR and using a defibrillator. The defibrillators are linked electronically to ambulance control so we can see the rhythm. And we're hoping we'll be able to improve outcome from cardiac arrest in rural areas. So watch this space. Cardiac problems now is over-triage. Because if you've not got a STEMI and you've got a non-STEMI, you've still got a 13% chance of having a major event within a month. So we take all those patients into hospital, usually to assess them using the heart score, and then doing a troponin and a 12-hour troponin. So that's 10 patients to pick up 1.3. So what we're doing now, and what we've done already, is we're putting the troponins in the back of the ambulance. And of course, we're using the ultra-sensitive ones as well. So that's our ex-health minister looking at the study. So now what we're thinking about is if they can turn up and do an ECG, assess the patient, and do the troponin, we can calculate the heart score, make a risk assessment, and leave these patients, some of these low-risk patients, at home and only take that in the hospital. Even if I reduce that from 100% to 50% of these patients coming in, it frees up so much time in the hospital and allows the patients to be treated more appropriately. So next one, ultrasound. We did a study because we wanted ultrasound, because if we can get echo in that in the back of the ambulance, great. So what we did was we thought, how much training do you need to do an ultrasound, say a fast scan, if you're somewhere remote? So what we did was we took complete novices who had never done it, showed them a 5-minute video on how to hold and switch on the ultrasound machine, gave them a prompt card, put them in a room with a medical student and a registrar, ED registrar at the far end, who could see the image and could see their hands, and he said, move it harder, a bit pressure, less. We then took the pictures that they got, sent them to a bunch of radiologists, and said, are these diagnostic? And they also performed the scans themselves, so they were actually trained guys. And in 91% of cases, the radiologists could not tell the difference between a trained ultrasonographer doing it and somebody new. So these are two scans of the kidney and the liver. The one on the left, EM doctor with ultrasound experience. The other one, a 14-year-old schoolgirl. Now, I'm not suggesting we're going to staff the healthcare system with schoolgirls, but the point is you don't have to have a large amount of training at the far end. You can get that information if you've got the ultrasound machine in the back of the ambulance or somewhere remote. They can perform that if somebody's at the far end of a link to interpret it. So we're looking at that now. So potentially we could turn up for chest pain, non-STEMI. We could even do an echo now and do a troponin on that, and the patient can get all their diagnostics, and only if they need to come to hospital be transferred in. And this is, we did it over Skype. You can do it with low stuff. We did it to Canada on a hillside. We actually sent the images, and they were of diagnostic quality. And we've done the same for ENT scopes, for all sorts of scopes for this reducing transfer. Okay, last few minutes, treatment. We have a very efficient stroke system. If you have a stroke, you're taken straight to hospital. You are video conferenced with a stroke consultant. What's this? It's a CAT scan, okay? So they go straight to the CT scanner. The CT scan sent. They are then examined to exclude mimics and then thrombolized at the far end. And at the moment, the fastest you will get thrombolized in Scotland is not in Glasgow or Edinburgh or Aberdeen. It's here in the Western Isles, because the patient goes straight to CT, it's sent to Aberdeen to one of our stroke consultants, and we treat them. And the next stage is we've even trialled overnight having the stroke consultant in New Zealand. So our consultants don't have to stay up. We send the data in New Zealand because they're working during the day, and we can actually do their work for them overnight as well. Much cheaper, much more effective, same quality. We've just completed a telepharmacy, so now we can actually dispense into nursing homes, into remote communities. For people with COPD, they get their physiotherapy in groups, or they can even get it at home with VC anywhere. This is my favorite, because these are stroke patients who are using the Wii to do their exercises. And what they do is, what they found was, they put everybody's, if a physio had a group of people recovering from this at home, what they would do is they'd put a league table, so it'd be A, patient A, B, C, D, and what happened is they started competing against each other. So if one was doing better, the next one would do better than that. So they got a 10% increase in that, and then what they did was they didn't have to visit these people, they visited the people who weren't doing well. Suddenly transformed, freed up a lot of time. And what we're doing at the moment, we have a spin-off from the SCTT called the Digital Health Institute, and what we're doing in that is we're actually looking at creating the ambulance of the future, which will have all these diagnostics on board. And we've been working. What we do basically is we take the evidence, then we get everybody in a room. We find out, is this going to work? Is this going to disadvantage or whatever? And then we come up with a tool that means when we implement this, it will work. So it's all about decision support using communications technology. This is just to say that they're doing this in the States now, where somebody actually oversees ITU and watches them doing this. It won't be long before resuscitations in rural hospitals or whatever will be overseen by a consultant experienced in that, giving advice. Monitoring, very quickly, because you won't be so interested in this, but there's a lot of work going on in monitoring of patients at home after they've been ill. That's a really old picture, but we've just had the results last Tuesday of a big study done which showed that home health monitoring for diabetes improves outcomes and equivalent to introducing a new drug. With heart failure, it reduces admissions significantly. COPD, not so good, because it's mainly end-stage hypertension very well. If you're interested, there's a great summary paper on this, and Telly Scott is the guy's, Professor Brian McInnestry, is doing all the work on this. And then, potential illness, Fitbits, everything's coming in now. People are monitoring themselves. This came out of the Olympics. You wear a patch that monitors your dehydration. Imagine that, a number of patients we get with elderly people with urinary tract infections get dehydrated and that and fall over. We can detect that before they even fall over. Interactive clothing. They're wearing clothing, it's actually in the fibre. It will tell you what their heart rate is, what their temperature is, and it will actually turn up and down the heating in their home or whatever. And passive monitoring is going to become more and more a thing in our everyday lives. Things like this. Your toilet will probably be able to pick up if you've had a UTI, will pick up if there's blood in your poo, and all the rest of it. So suddenly, you're not having to do anything. And when you get up in the morning, It'll use an infrared scan to see if you've got a bit of a temperature. It'll check if you're dehydrated, and then they'll maybe link you through to the doctor automatically to give you some advice and all the rest of it. This is all possible now. It's how we use it. So, last few minutes, back to Bond. Good. When Bond got poisoned, what did he do? First thing. He tried to make himself sick. Self-management. Best thing we want. Patients should try and self-manage first. Tried to self-manage, didn't work. So what did he do then? He went to his telemedicine booth. Obviously, it's an Aston Martin in this case. So he went to his telemedicine booth, and then what did he do? He called somebody. And when he called, then you had his medical records available to them, and they knew who he was. He put the thing in his arm. What did that do? Analyzed his blood, took his heart rate, gave you all the physiology that was available to him. Near patient testing, physiological. Then what did he do? Yeah, telepharmacy, jabbed himself with the Fab antibodies, okay? Then defibrillator. And then the other thing is, the person who came and saved him was not a healthcare professional. It was somebody who knew the kit, who knew how to treat him. And then the last thing, he didn't go to hospital. He avoided a hospital admission. And the last thing is, obviously, he went on to save the world from terrorism. So telemedicine is good. The only thing is, that's 2006. I'm trying to write stuff for Bond now. I can't do it because now Bond would be wearing a piece of clothing. His DJ would be monitoring him continuously. Before he even knew he was ill, it would be going, beep, you need to go now and take the antidote and that. So where's the excitement in that if he does it? So I'm struggling to come up with ideas for the new ones. Okay, so just to finish, this is the Dubai Sevens. This is the reason I'm actually here. So that's me in the kilt there. What do you call it? This guy here is Professor Keith McLean, who I went to school with, a dear friend of mine. What do you call it? He works for the commercial scientific branch of the Australian government. And they've come up with, I get a lot of my ideas from him. And there's stuff about pre-hospital care that is really hot off the press that I'll be speaking about this afternoon. So there you go. There's an advert for my afternoon's talk. And just to finish on, I have to name drop, obviously, because you'll realize there's a very, very famous person on this slide. And of course, it's James Robson. James Robson is the team doctor for the Scottish rugby team and for the Lions. And he's my friend. I have no idea who this guy is. Right, I don't know if we have time for questions, but thank you very much.